What is a dollar anyway? Where does our money come from? Why does it have value? Most people don't know the answer to these very basic questions, mainly because the thought never really crosses our mind. But what is a dollar? The origins of American money come from Article 1 of the Constitution. Section 8 states, Congress shall have the power to coin money, regulate the value thereof and of foreign coin, and fix the standard of weights and measures. There was paper money at the time, it's not like it hadn't been invented, yet they specifically give Congress the authority to coin money and regulate its value by setting the standard of weights and measures, or how much precious metal was in the coins. Many of the constitutional authors were also members of the first Congresses, and together with George Washington, they laid out our foundational laws. In 1792, they passed the Coinage Act, an act establishing a mint and regulating the coins of the United States. This law created and defined America's money. It calls for a coin called a dollar, each to contain about 3/4 of an ounce of silver. It creates a dollar, half dollar, quarter, dime, and 5 cent half dime, all made of silver. It calls for a coin called an eagle, each worth $10 and containing about a half an ounce of gold. It calls for an eagle, a half eagle, and a quarter eagle, all made of gold. It requires each coin bear an impression of liberty and the word liberty. There would be no Caesars in America, there would be no King Georges. Our sovereign was liberty. Therefore, the legal definition of a dollar is money, a silver coin of the United States of the value of a tenth eagle, and eagle, money, a gold coin of the United States of the value of $10. This is called lawful money, and for the first 80 years of our history, this was our money. In 1794, the U.S. Mint started producing coins, and they looked like this. Section 10 states, no state shall coin money, emit bills of credit, make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debts. Emit bills of credit means to issue paper promissory notes as money. By requiring the states to tender all payments in gold and silver coin, they anchored the economy to gold and silver coin. This also limits the banking system's ability to loan out money it doesn't have, what's known as fractional reserve banking. These two sections together very clearly create a monetary system based on gold and silver coinage, managed by Congress. Like everything else they did, they set up a system in which power, in this case the nation's wealth, was distributed to all the people rather than being centralized in the hands of a few. America had two short-lived central banks. The first Bank of the United States was established in 1791 despite protest from Thomas Jefferson, among others, against its constitutionality. In 1811, James Madison revoked its charter. A second Bank of the United States was formed in 1816. This time their enemy was Andrew Jackson. He despised the idea of a private bank controlling America's money. Its charter was revoked in 1833. Ironically, this man, who adorns our 20, Revolutionary War hero and former President of the United States, has engraved on his tombstone, "I beat the bank." In the mid-1800s, when gold was discovered in California, the mint added a $1 tenth eagle and a $20 double eagle in order to disperse the gold across the population, honoring the founder's principle of decentralizing power by spreading the wealth. In 1861, Abraham Lincoln decided to print paper money to finance the Civil War. The Treasury reeled in coins and replaced them with the greenback. These were denominated not only in dollars, but even in cents. Virtually all of the money in America was paper. Now, in order for paper money to have value, it needs to be a legal document, so the wording on a bill is very important. Notice the front of this 5, it says, "Promise to pay the bearer $5," and below that, in swirly writing under a swirly signature, it says, "Payable at the Treasury of the United States." So this is not money, but a promise for money, a loan. This would be redeemable for five $1 silver coins at the U.S. Treasury, and it would require you to travel to Washington, D.C. to get it. The value of the dollar plummeted. After the war, the Mint resumed coining money. They replaced the silver dime with a 5-cent nickel, allowing the Mint more silver to quickly rebuild their reserves. The dollar climbed back up, even going through periods of increasing spending power. But the U.S. government was still issuing paper dollars in the form of U.S. notes. Notice the legalese on the back. It says, "This note is a legal tender at its face value for all debts, public and private, except duties on imports and interest on the public debt." In other words, neither foreign nations nor the international bankers who finance them will accept this as money because it's not money. It's a note. It's a loan. It's an IOU. In the 1880s, the Treasury started issuing a new type of paper money called a certificate. Remember, the wording on paper money is very important. This certifies that there has been deposited in the Treasury of the United States one silver dollar, payable to the bearer on demand. So a $1 bill was backed by one silver dollar coin, a $2 bill by two silver dollars, a five silver dollars. You don't find the word note anywhere on this bill because this isn't an IOU. If you look, there is no restriction for imports or interest on the public debt. Foreign nations and international bankers will accept this as money because it is money. America went quite a while with four different types of money depending on what you were doing with it. We had gold and silver coins, lawful money. We had certificates, the paper version of lawful money. We had U.S. notes, public debt that did not certify a deposit but promised payment in coin on demand. And then there were banknotes, which were honored as money by other banks. Each had its appropriate use and purpose. 1914 brings us the Federal Reserve System, the new American central bank. They begin printing Federal Reserve notes, a new kind of government-sanctioned banknote. Again, the wording on the bill is very important. On the back it states, "It is redeemable in gold on demand at the Treasury Department in Washington or in gold coin or lawful money at any Federal Reserve Bank." This is a demand note similar to the greenback. It's redeemable for gold but only in Washington or a member bank. It says, "This bill can be exchanged for gold or lawful money." If something can be exchanged for lawful money, then it isn't lawful money. Remember, lawful money is a silver coin of the United States. While this may be redeemable for money, it's not the money itself. In 1932, FDR demonetized gold. He ended the production of gold coins and certificates as well as silver dollars. In order to stimulate the economy, he allowed the Federal Reserve to print notes that were not redeemable for lawful money. With this restriction lifted, the Fed rapidly expanded the money supply, and the dollar fell into a slide of devaluation from which it would never recover. In 1957, the U.S. Treasury produced the last silver certificate. The Federal Reserve note had become so common, few people even noticed it was gone. In 1963, JFK signed Executive Order No. 11110, reauthorizing silver certificates and silver dollars. Tragically, he was killed soon thereafter. His successor, Lyndon Baines Johnson, didn't share his economic vision, and the order was never carried out. Ironically, the Kennedy half dollar is the last silver money America ever produced. With no restriction of redeemable coinage, the number of dollars in circulation has skyrocketed while the actual value of the dollar has plummeted. Prices keep going up because the dollar is worth less and less, and this is where we are today.